Hi, I'm Dustin Abbott, and I'm here today to give you a look at the autofocus performance and the various aspects from the new Canon 85mm f1.4 IS USM. We've already determined that while this lens, I believe, renders very nicely, and I think that some people may have kind of overreacted to some of the findings that I have had in terms of how its resolution compares to, the Tamron, for example, and then by extension to the Sigma 85mm f1.4 Art, both of which of those lenses, by the way, are very near the top of the heap in optical performance across any lenses. And so, they're very strong competitors, and I think that's the reality of where what Canon is facing, Nikon is facing when it comes to the third parties these days, is that these lenses, in terms of absolute optical chartable performance, the third party lenses are very, very good, and in many cases not worse, maybe even better than what first party lenses are. However, traditionally, what has set first-party lenses apart is their autofocus systems. And if you're not familiar with how this works, Canon and Nikon, they don't really license their autofocus technology to third-party companies like Sigma or Tamron. And so as a result, those companies have to do some reverse engineering to determine focus algorithms, which is why both Sigma and Tamron have come up with their autofocus docks, their USB dock, their tapping console, because it helps to circumvent some of the challenges presented by that. But obviously, when it comes to I hesitate to call it the predecessor of this lens, because it seems like Canon intends to continue to sell the 85mm f1.2L Mark II alongside this lens. So don't think of this lens necessarily as a replacement for that lens, more of an option to it. But for most people, their most significant complaint about the 85mm f1.2L Mark II is its very slow focus speed, which is leisurely, and it's a focus-by-wire system in the manual focus ring. And so as a result, let's just say that the focus aspect is not really people's favorite part of that lens. So obviously Canon had one important challenge in designing this lens is they needed to design a faster focusing lens and to kind of eliminate the focus by wire, both of which they've done, by the way. And so to give you an idea of the focus speed of the lens itself, here's a look at a video where I just show you the focus rack from minimum focus to the focus point, from infinity focus to the focus point. And from these, you can see that focus speed is definitely improved.
You can see, of course, split second there. Let's go to the other extreme, which is a little more defocused towards, in this situation, towards infinity.
Now, if you want to see how that compares to the alternatives, you're going to find that I can show you the Tamron focus speed, which is roughly about the same as we'll see here.
And you can see split second. I would say, just a hair of a split second more than the Canon, but not much. Now, I'll focus all the way to infinity. And pretty much instantaneous there. I wouldn't say there's any difference in focus speed.
And the Sigma Art is maybe just a hair slower, but not in any kind of really discernible sense. And so good news is that this lens focuses quickly. Beyond that, however, it's important to determine whether or not it's capable of focusing accurately, because we've determined that focus speed will help to set it apart from the Canon 85 1.2L Mark II. But really, it's going to be focus accuracy that is going to allow it to be set apart from the Sigma 85mm f1.4 Art, a lens that it might not be able to top optically in a number of metrics. It's arguable, debatable about the rendering, but of course that's a taste thing. It's not something you can really chart or test per se. And so I think it's going to be important for Canon to distinguish itself by autofocus accuracy with this lens. And so we're going to jump in and we're going to look at how that plays out in the real world, and then also take a little bit of a look at the focus tracking, along with how well it focuses if you move off the center group and you move off to the side focus positions. Because my experience in testing the Sigma, for example, I found that it focused accurately and consistently in my center group on this Canon 5D Mark IV. It didn't do nearly as well when I moved off to the peripheral points. And so let's see if this lens is able to do a better job there. So in our first test here, we want to evaluate autofocus consistency. And so I've shown you here, I've got a plugin for Lightroom called Show Focus Point. So it shows the overlay of my 5D Mark IV, and we're using the center point, the most accurate point. And so we would hope that we would get consistent autofocus performance out of this. And yes, I have run calibration on the lens, and note that in between each one of these shots, I have defocused the lens. And so it's having direct complete focus to reacquire focus here once again. And so as you can see, I've also chosen a scene that's got, you know, a lot of activity here. And at the same time, I've also chosen a scene that's not incredibly well lit. It's not bad, but it's not great, because I also want you to be able to, I know that a lot of you are going to be shooting in, you know, wedding type venues, and so you're not always going to be working in optimal lighting conditions. So we're going to, without going to an extreme, I wanted to present, you know, something of a challenge here. So what we're going to do is we've got 16 shots, and so you can see where the focus point should be. Some are right in this area here. And so what we want to see is consistency. So one, second shot, third shot, fourth shot, fifth shot, sixth shot, seventh shot, eighth shot, ninth shot, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, and 16th. So what you saw was very, very minor focus variances here, all of which would be, you know, accurately or acceptably focused under those conditions. And so no problem on that test. So what happens if we move it more to an extreme? And here is a composition that might be a pretty common point for you to choose if you were trying to shoot rule of thirds, and maybe this would represent an eye on your subject. So let's see how well it does if we, you know, switch things up a bit. So here's a look at that first shot, which, you know, shows good focus here. Our focus point was up here, and so, you know, maybe not perfectly nailed. But if that's kind of where the focus point's actually getting, what we want to see above all is the consistency here. So second shot, third shot, fourth shot, fifth shot, sixth shot, seventh shot, eighth shot, ninth shot, tenth shot. So all in all, they're also a good report, because out of all of those shots, while we saw maybe a tiny bit more of a focus shift in that, we also got consistent, you know, consistently focused results in all of that. So I can safely tell you that that did better in that test than, say, what the Sigma 85mm f1.4 art did for me, at least in the copy that I reviewed. Now, in some cases, I ramped up the lighting difficulty. And so here you can see I did a comparison with the Tamron at f1.8, you know, to have a commonality there. And so you can see I'm shooting at ISO 1600 and a shutter speed of 1/25th here. Of course, this is on a tripod, obviously, defocused in between. And so what I found is that on this particular focus point, which does blink, by the way, just as you're looking through the viewfinder, so it's one of the challenging ones, okay? What I found, and the reason why this photo is blurry, is it represented the fact that at this particular focus point, I could not achieve focus lock under these conditions with the lens. It was a combination of either not enough contrast and the challenge of just shooting at that distance, not enough light, whatever, it wouldn't lock. Now, this is what the photo should look like. You can see that using live view, I was able to lock focus in this particular scenario, where I was not able to do it through a phase detect. And so, you know, in certain challenging lighting conditions, you may run into the fact, even with this first party lens, where it doesn't really want to lock focus. Now here's an example at maybe a more typical portrait distance, and I've used this in a previous episode just to show that, you know, my wife, who is not a greatly experienced photographer, this is shooting with the center point, but this is at f1.4, and certainly there's plenty of lenses that would not lock focus accurately, you know, with f1.4 and in this kind of situation, but you can see that a focus was achieved accurately here. Here's another, you know, situation where there's lots of, you know, things, distractions to capture focus. And so we've got foreground elements that I was shooting over and trying to shoot beyond that to a background element. You can see we have gotten the focus that I wanted. Focus is actually right in here. And so that was a good performance there. Here's another shot. This is from about 15 feet away and, you know, kind of shooting through some reeds and whatever. And so once again, accurate focus locked there. Here's from a bit of a side angle, and so I wanted to get this, you know, bolt head here is what I was shooting at, and you can see that, you know, it definitely locked focus on where I wanted the focus point to be. So positive result there. Here, this is from the sequence with my wife. We're out walking, and so you can see once again, this is a little bit of a closer distance in the shot of me. You can see that we have gotten very nice focus, again, f1.4. And of course, you can also see a rendering here is really, really nice. The scene has melted away beautifully behind her. And even in this transition area, this isn't really about bokeh, but you can see it's handled the transition zone quite nicely there. Here's in quite dim lighting conditions here, and so you're going to be able to see there's more a noise there, but you can see that the lens has locked on accurately at f1.4. Also, just, you know, kind of an around the house shot, I was shooting for my son's eyelashes, and well, you can see the result. We've gotten what we were looking for there. Here's also something from the side, you know, a very narrow, plane of focus here, and so lots of opportunity to miss. You can see that the lens did not. Interestingly, this was in AF servo mode, by the way, just shooting a quick shot there. Now, in some ways, I'm very impressed by what it did in this shot. I was actually shooting through a decoration. It's that same kind of reindeer decoration, lots of shiny surfaces, and, you know, obviously a lot of light bouncing around in here, shooting through that in a very narrow window to try to get at my son's eyelashes, which you can see that the lens has, you know, nailed focus in the setting and has given me a really kind of unique, cool result. And just so you can see the focus point that I used for this particular shot, using that plugin again to show that it certainly was not a center point. It was a, you know, kind of a rule of third shot, and yet it has nailed focus. So, you know, that's certainly a positive thing. Just so you can see settings, it's ISO 800, f1.4, 1/100th of a second, and that's a handheld shot there. Now, next I'm going to show you some, you know, movement type shots. We're gonna look at a few sequences of tracking action. And so I shot on multiple days, multiple kind of scenarios, trying to test the tracking. So this is evidence that here my son was running full tilt. This is one of a burst of 70 plus shots. So you can see that even in kind of extreme conditions, it is able to give you an accurate focus. And you can see that's a very well focused image. However, that's a kind of a best case scenario there. Let's look at some of these sequences and make a few quick observations. So let's take a look at this time lapse here. This is a burst of a little over 70 frames here. And so you can see that there's some intermittent results there as we try to track. At the beginning, when he's further away, we're basically not getting anything. And then we enter a sweet spot from about 35 to maybe 15 feet away, where we got, you know, mostly locked during that time. Actually, in that particular burst, I only got a 43% keeper rate when examining them closer. That is 30 out of 70 shots. And so certainly, you know, not as promising as what I would have liked. So just out of curiosity, I wanted to see if it did better if I turned the IS off, since I didn't need it because of the shutter speed. And I found, in fact, that it did make a difference. And I'll run that again. In this particular sequence, out of 68 shots, I got 40 that were accurately focused, jumping up from 43% to 59%. And so if you are trying to track action, just note that if you don't need the IS, you may get better results if you turn it off. Now, just as a point of comparison, I did the exact same test at the same time with the Tamron 85mm f1.8 VC. And so what I found is that neither lens did good when the runner was far away. You can see focus is not locked, Ed, but the Tamron picks up and was really, really consistent during the middle group. This is with the VC on, and I got 40 out of 68 or 59% with the VC on. And Tamron may do a bit better with the VC on because I have it programmed for that mode 3 where it only VC only turns on right at the moment of capture. So it may interfere less with tracking action. When I turned the VC off, I got a slightly better result. I got 40 out of 66 frames or 41%. What I noticed is that the Tamron did better in the middle section. It was more consistent, but you'll see as the runner gets close here, even in this sequence, that the Canon actually did a better job in that final range. The Tamron, you know, missed most of those shots. There's only a few that are caught in the middle. And so, you know, it's kind of a mixed bag with both of those. So as you can see, you know, it's kind of a what I would consider a good news, bad news situation, mostly good news. The most important thing is that this lens does focus accurately, even at a very demanding 85 millimeter focal length and an f1.4 aperture. So bottom line, that's the biggest deal, is that you want to be able to focus on eyes and have eyes sharply in focus if you're a wedding or a portrait photographer. Now, when it comes to shooting action, I would say that I don't think that this lens is going to be a replacement for most sports type photographers for, you know, the 70-200 f2.8 L Mark II. And that lens is just, it's a fabulous sports lens, and it's the reason why you'll see it at the sidelines of any number of sporting events. It just does a fabulous job. I don't think that this lens is going to replace that. I don't think the keeper rate's as high, and if, you know, you stop it down to minimize the depth of field, well, you might as well be using the better lens for that kind of work to begin with. And so if you're a sports photographer, I still don't think that this is going to be your top choice. It's not that it's worse than any of the alternatives at the 85 millimeter focal length. I think it's probably the best of the bunch, but the best of the bunch in this kind of lens doesn't equal out to the best tool for the job. And so if I were you, I would stick with something like a 70-200 for that kind of work. Beyond that, we found that while the lens is capable of focusing accurately at outer points, unfortunately, like just about every lens that I've seen, your accuracy is better in the center type group. Now, I do think that it focuses more consistently on the outer points than what I saw from the Sigma 85 Art, but I also found when I directly tested it side by side with the Tamron 85mm, which is, by the way, an extremely good focusing lens, at least the copy I have and after the calibration I've done. But I found that the Canon was no better. In fact, which lens was better kind of varied from point to point. And so, but I mean, bottom line is that I don't feel like I would be limited as a portrait photographer with this in selecting the focus point that I wanted and getting the focus result that I wanted. And so, bottom line, I think that Canon has done something important here, and that is to give it a distinguishing mark outside of image quality in the quality of the autofocus, both in terms of speed and accuracy. And those things are very, very important metrics for that. You know, alongside, of course, the fact that it has an extremely effective image stabilizer, good for about 4 stops of hand holding. And so that in itself, that right there may be the single biggest, if I were choosing between the Sigma and the Canon, that would be probably one of the biggest selling points for me, because that IS does make a big difference. And I will also say, while I'm not on build quality right now, I will also say that this form factor, it appeals to me more than what the Sigma does. The Sigma is a huge lens, and it's a heavy lens, and I think that this is a more reasonably sized lens, in my opinion. And so take it for what that's worth. I'm Dustin Abbott, and I'll be back to give you my final verdict on the lens on this. And so in the meantime, down below, you can find the image gallery linkage, you can find buying links, and of course, you can follow me on social media. And please go ahead and click that subscribe button. And thanks to all of you that are. Have a great day.